Hello dear children, welcome back to chemistry class. In our last class we have learned what are the conditions that are required for a chemical reaction to take place. So we have learned close physical contact and supply of energy. Any of this should be there for a chemical reaction to take place. So we have already learned various chemical reactions which take place by close physical contact. Now in continuation to that we will see what are the chemical reactions or how chemical reactions would take place by supply of energy. Energy can be supplied for a chemical reaction to take place, and energy can be in different forms. That is either heat energy, supply of light energy or supply of electrical energy, by supply of pressure or by supply of a catalyst. Now we will see them one by one. First, let's begin with supply of heat energy. Many of the chemical reactions take place by supply of heat energy. So what happens when we supply heat energy to reactants? When we supply heat energy to reactants, the particles of the reactants will collide much faster and this will initiate a chemical reaction. So let us see few examples of chemical reactions which are initiated by supply of heat energy. We have already seen this example, that is zinc carbonate on heating giving the products zinc oxide and the evolution of carbon dioxide gas. So here, as you see here, zinc carbonate, which is initially white in color, as it is heated, chemical reaction takes place and the products formed are zinc oxide with the evolution of carbon dioxide gas. So zinc oxide formed is now in yellow color. Another example of a chemical reaction is reaction of nitrogen with oxygen. Nitrogen reacts with oxygen at a very high temperature, around 3000 degrees Celsius, to give the products nitric oxide. So here we see that nitrogen reacts with oxygen. Again, this reaction takes place only when there is a supply of heat energy. And that heat energy is nothing but this 3000 degrees Celsius, that is the temperature. So when heat energy is supplied, reaction between nitrogen and oxygen takes place to give the product nitric oxide. Now let us see next chemical reaction where there is supply of energy, that is by the supply of light energy. We are all familiar with a very common example of a chemical reaction which takes place by supply of light energy. That is nothing but photosynthesis that takes place in plants. So we have already learned that during the process of photosynthesis, carbon dioxide reacts with water in the presence of sunlight, that is energy is supplied in the form of light energy. So in the presence of sunlight and in the presence of chlorophyll that is present in leaves to form the products glucose and oxygen. So here this chemical reaction takes place by supply of light energy, that is from sunlight. It captures this light energy for this chemical reaction to take place. Another example of a chemical reaction where there is supply of light energy is reaction of hydrogen with chlorine. As you see here, hydrogen reacts with chlorine in the presence of sunlight to give the product hydrogen chloride. So this reaction would take place much explosively when there is supply of direct sunlight. But if we supply diffused sunlight, the reaction would be a very slow process. But in both the cases, product will be the same, that is hydrogen chloride. So when there is supply of direct sunlight, it would be an explosive reaction. Now let's take another example, that is reaction of silver salts with light energy. Generally, when silver salts, that is, say for example, let's take silver bromide. As you see here in the picture, when silver bromide, when it is exposed to light, it decomposes in order to form the products silver and bromine. So in the presence of sunlight, silver salts, so here we have taken silver bromide, it decomposes to form the product silver and bromine. So as you see here, silver bromide, which is actually light yellow in color, So in the presence of sunlight, it decomposes to form silver and bromine. So silver now appears to be in a gray, metallic gray color. So this is how the reaction would take place. So generally, silver salts would react with sunlight. So that is why they are generally stored in dark colored bottles or amber colored bottles, like how you see here in the picture. So this is how a chemical reaction would take place when there is supply of light energy. Other than light energy or heat energy, electric energy can also be supplied in order for a chemical reaction to take place. There are certain chemical reactions which are carried out by supply of electric current. So those chemical reactions which are carried out by supply of electric current or by the passage of electricity through the reactants which are present in solution state or in molten state, such chemical reactions are called electrochemical reactions. So which means when we pass electricity through the reactants which are present in solution state or in molten state, such chemical reactions that occur are called electrochemical reactions. Now we will see what exactly happens when we pass electricity through the reactants. When we pass electricity through the reactants, electricity will split or it will dissociate the reactants into ions. We have already learned ions are charged particles. So because of the formation of ions, some reaction is carried out and this will lead to the formation of the final product. One such example of an electrochemical reaction is electrolysis of water. So here what we are going to do is we are going to pass electricity or electric current through the reactant. So here the reactant is water. So when we pass electric current through water, electric current will split or dissociate water to form the desired products. So that is why it is called electrolysis, which means electric current is passed to split the reactant. That is called electrolysis. Now look into this picture here. We have a beaker, a glass beaker that is taken with a solution here. And we have two test tubes which are filled with solutions and that are inverted into this beaker that contains the solution. There are two metal rods here and these are now connected to two terminals of battery. As you see here in the picture, when electric current is passed through this, it is observed that bubbles of gas are produced in these two tubes that are connected to this container. Now we have already learned when bubbles are produced, this indicates that there is evolution of gas. So this indicates that there is evolution of gas. So here what we are doing is we are passing electricity through the reactant, that is water. Now because of the passage of electricity, it breaks or it dissociates water to form hydrogen and oxygen. So hydrogen gas and oxygen gas are collected in these tubes that are connected to this container. Now the tube that has got more amount of gas or the tube that has occupied more volume of gas is hydrogen gas. So the gas collected in this test tube, that is the second test tube, is hydrogen gas. And the test tube that has less volume of gas is oxygen gas. So as you see here in the equation, when electric current is passed through water, electric current dissociates or it splits water to form the products hydrogen gas and oxygen gas. So we get the desired product. Remember that pure water is a bad conductor of electricity. So only if it conducts electricity or only if it allows electricity to pass through this, we get the desired product or a chemical reaction would take place. So since water is a poor conductor of electricity, we need to add dilute acid into this water. So that is called as acidified water. So we mix dilute acid with water and that is now acidified water. And it is this acidified water that we use as the solution here in this test. So by the usage of acidified water, and when passing electric current splits or it decomposes water to form the products hydrogen and oxygen. Same is the case when we pass electric current through molten sodium chloride. As I have already told you, when electric current is passed through solution or reactant that is in the molten state, a chemical reaction would take place. So now, what is happening here is electrolysis of molten state, that is molten sodium chloride. Let's see how the reaction is. As you see here, when electric current is passed through sodium chloride, that is in the molten state, electric current, it splits or it dissociates sodium chloride to form the desired products, that is sodium and chlorine gas. Sodium that is formed is in the solid state, while chlorine that is formed is in the gaseous state. So this is how electricity or electric current is passed through the reactants which are present in the solution state or in the molten state in order to give the desired products.